Hello, dear student. This is Professor Ashok Kumar. I work at Department of Mechanical Engineering at Dr. Subhas Technical Campus. Dear student, today's topic that is chapter number 9, Power Screw and Threaded Joint, part 2. If you have seen my previous video lecture, then I have entered a video lecture was on same chapter, chapter number 9, Power Screw and Threaded Joint. It's a part 1. So particularly in that video lecture, I have discussed about only power screw. That means an introduction of power screw, types of power screw, various forms of power screw and its comparison, various stresses due to external loading on power screw that we have also discussed. And at the end, we have solved few numericals on the theory, what we have discussed in that. So in particular this lecture we will discuss the remaining portion of this chapter, and that is threaded joint. Actually entire chapter number 9 from fundamental of machine design subject is divided in main two parts. One is power screw, that what we have discussed in my previous video lecture, and other part is that is the threaded joint. Dear student, before going on the types of fastener or the joints and its analysis, let's have an introduction about fastener, because it is very important to understand for everyone actually basic meaning of fastener. So fastener, or we can say that the threaded joint, is a mechanical device that connects two or more components together. That means suppose you are finding any devices or two components which are engaged or assembled by means of some mechanical device, then we term it as a fastener. And as we know that particularly in our manufacturing sector, our production and fabrication sector, we frequently require numbers of parts to be joined for to achieve a specific operation like power transmission, motion transmission, even force transmission, torque transmission, etc. So in order to divide the entire fastening process, there are broadly classified in two ways. Fastening can be possible in two ways. One is temporary joining or fastening, another is the permanent joining or fastening. See, this two classification is purely made based on the requirement of that particular parts. That means suppose the two parts that you require to join is assembled and disassembled within some frequent period of time, on the basis of that your need of that assembly and disassembly, these two joining method are categorized. So if we are talking about temporary joining, then basically there are main four subdivision of that temporary joining, or we can say that temporary joining can be possible with the help of fastening, with the help of press fit, seam joint and key joint. As we know that in case of fastening, there is a nut and a screw, or we can say that nut and bolt system is there. By clamping and tightening or screwing and unscrewing of two plates or parts or machine component, fastening can be possible. Similarly, press fit, which by applying external pressure, two components that we require to join are assembled. So this is what about the press fit. Seam joint is very similar as that of the welding process, but over here, except the continuous welding, in case of seam joint, there are spot type of the joining is there. That means a distance, or we can say that there is a seam in a few numbers which connects and disconnects the particular two parts that we require to join. Last one is the key joint. As we know that our vehicles or the gearbox or the any machineries, in order to have the power transmission or torque transmission, we are using shaft. So if you have seen shaft, then in outer periphery of that particular shaft, there is a slot for key, and similar slot is provided on hub of rotating member like the gears, sprocket, pulley, etc., which are mounted on the peripheral surface of shaft. And between those two slot that are provided, key is inserted in between. So over here, definitely we can say that key is the connecting member between that rotating parts like a pulley or gear to that of the transmission shaft. Once you remove it, the rotating member and shaft will disassemble very easily. So all these four method highlights about the temporary joining. That means it offer the assemble and disassemble operation of mating parts frequently. Whereas some applications find where you don't require to disassemble frequently your mating parts or machine component parts. So this all the parts require permanent joining, and permanent joining are classified in main four types. First one is the welding, second one is the riveting, third one is the coupling, and the last one is the soldering. We all know that welding is done with an electric arc resistance principle, or you may also go through gas welding also. So by two parts that are welded with the help of welding operation can be possible for the permanent type of joining that is possible from the welding. Similarly, if we are talking about riveting joint, then we know that the two cell, or we can say the two plates that we require to join. First of all, a drill holes makes between two parts that we require to join, and rivet is inserted. The shank or the tail end of the rivet is crushed away so that there will be a joint between two mating parts. But if now after riveting, suppose you require to disassemble both of the plates or the parts, you at least destroy the rivet. So this kind of the joining method destroy either two parts that have been joined, or either it will destroy rivet itself. Third one is the coupling. We know that the coupling is play very vital and essential role for the power and torque transmission. Coupling basically connect two shaft permanently. That means during operation or power transmission, suppose you require to have the disengagement and engagement of two shaft like driver shaft and driven shaft frequently, at that time coupling does not offer so. So this is why it comes under the permanent joining. And last one, that is the soldering. We know that the soldering operation is carried away to join two similar parts, and it also offer a permanent type of joining or fastening. Now, after classification and discussion about the types of joining, few topics or subtopics that we need to discuss here. First one is the permanent fastening required destroy in assembly. That means what we have discussed in case of last slide, that permanent welding, suppose you are going for the welding operation, and after welding or after the few periodic time you require to disassemble the two parts, then you at least destroy the welded joint that you have made. So ultimately, similar procedure or same concept, it is applicable for soldering, for coupling, for other permanent types of joining. So over here, main the thing is that if you prefer the permanent joining, and if you require to have the disassembly of that permanent joint, you have to at least destroy the mating parts for the welding mechanism itself. Generally, thread forms is a continuous groove on cylindrical part. That means if you have seen thread, then it is a continuous in helical shape. And last topic, that is the basically in threaded joint, we know that there are basically two parts. One is nut, another is a bolt. Now, if we are talking about the advantage and disadvantage of that particular threaded joint, then first advantage is that it is the reliable joint because of large clamping force. We know that there is a nut and bolt assembly. So by tightening well a bolt, you will have the large clamping force, and it gives a so reliable joint. Second advantage is that assembly and disassembly is very easy and simple. As we know that assembly and disassembly is very easy because just you require a simple spanner. You have to unlock and lock, screw and unscrew the nut that you have already tight, So we can say that the assembly and disassembly is very easy, and it can be operated by any person. There is no any kind of skillful operator is required to do so. Third advantage is that small amount of force is required, because we know that at the end of spanner we just putting small amount of force for the tight of the bolt. So here, if you are using a threaded joint or fastener, just small amount of force is required. It's very simple to manufacture. That is fourth advantage. We know that in bulk numbers, large quantity numbers, it is produced within few periodic times. So it is very easy to manufacture, and of course, due to mass production, is very easy. It is cheaper and also easily available in a market. So this is what the few advantages if you are using threaded joint or screw and nut assembly. Now, if you are talking about disadvantage, then first disadvantage is that trace concentration near the threaded portion. This is so trace concentration, you need to first very important. Then we should discuss about the trace concentration in particular threaded joint. Suppose you have given one thread particularly like that. So over here, and this is the entire nut and bolt itself. Over here, you may see that in particular this threaded portion which contains nut and bolt assembly, there is a frequently change of its cross section or area. So over here, whatever the clamping force or whatever the torque that you are applying through spanner, it will move, and it will be suddenly, it will be moved through this entire portion, and it will be suddenly rise and it will be suddenly down. So we can say that in particular threaded portion, due to slightly variation of a cross section, the trace intensity will be very in high. Trace intensity will be change its magnitude from one section to other section. So it may possible that the near threaded portion, where the area is very small as compared to other portion or other section, there will be high trace. So it goes to have the chance of failure. So this is the first disadvantage of the threaded joint if you are using. Second disadvantage is that due to vibration, it may possible that you have your joint or your mating part assembly will loose, because we know that due to heavy vibration, nut that you have so tightened will be lose its gripping and clamping force to mating parts and mating parts. So it may possible that after few time or few days, your joint or your nut and bolt assembly will lose its clamping force and joint will become loose. Now, after that advantage and disadvantage of threaded joint or a fastener, let's have the discussion on terminology of threaded joint. Dear friends, terminology is the terms that are related with particular machine component. So over here we will discuss the numbers of terms which are associated with the threaded joint. First and most important terminology is major diameter. Look at the diagram. This is the major diameter. From this diagram, one can easily understand and explain what is actually major diameter. We can say that it is the maximum diameter of the thread having external or internal thread cut on the surface. That means you have to measure the maximum diameter among all diameter, and that maximum diameter will be known as a major diameter or outer diameter or larger diameter. In case of internal threaded portion, a major diameter should be also taken as a larger. So there will be no any specific content about the major diameter definition. Just if you are finding maximum diameter from either internal or external thread, that will be known as a major or larger diameter. Second terminology is core diameter. It is also known as a small diameter or minor diameter. Look at the diagram. This is this represents the small diameter, and definition is very simple. It is the smallest diameter of an external or internal diameter of a thread is known as core diameter. Once again, in core diameter 2, just you have to calculate the minor or smaller diameter among all diameters, whether it is external or internal thread, what it may be. But if you are calculating or measuring the smaller diameter, then it will be known as a core diameter. Third one, that is the pitch diameter. It is the imaginary diameter of the pitch cylinder of a parallel thread in a specified plane normal to the axis. That means it is an imaginary diameter and it is measured through the pitch cylinder. That means this pitch cylinder is this, and so you have to measure the distance between a pitch circle of that particular thread is known as a pitch diameter. Fourth terminology is pitch. It is the distance from a point of one thread to the corresponding point on the next thread. Basically, as shown in the figure, look at the diagram, this is pitch, and as per the definition, it is the distance, or we can say that it is the axial distance parallel to the axis of a thread fastener or threaded joint. So it is the distance parallel to the thread axis and measured between two similar points on two consecutive thread. That means suppose your pitch that you are measuring from here, so next point on the same thread should be selected over here. So these two point which have the some axial distance, if you are measuring it will be the pitch. So in simple, pitch is defined as the distance between two consecutive points on thread is known as a pitch. Fifth terminology is lead, and lead is generally defined as a distance which a screw thread advances axially and one revolution of screw or not. It clearly means that if you are rotating this screw by 360 degree or even one revolution, whatever this threaded portion or say nut moves in axial direction either upward or downward, that axial distance that moved by this particular threaded portion either nut or the bolt is known as a lead. Then after crest, it is the top surface of the threaded joint. For example, this is a thread. So crest is nothing but topmost portion or surface of the any threaded portion is known as crest. So this is crest. Root, it is the bottom surface created by the two adjacent flanks of the thread. That means suppose this is one thread and this is other thread, one another thread. So this is what the bottom surface which is connected or which is created by two adjacent flanks. This is flank. So this portion or this surface is known as a root. Now number 8, that is the depth of the thread. It is the perpendicular distance between crest and root. That means if you are measuring the distance between crest and root in perpendicular direction to axis of the threaded portion or threaded nut or bolt, what you have, that will be known as a depth of thread. Number 9, that is the flank. It is the surface joining the crest and root. So this is crest and this is root. Both of the points are joining by a common surface. So this surface is known as a flank, helix angle. It is the angle made by the thread with a plane perpendicular to the axis of thread. That means just you have to measure an angle between a flank like that and perpendicular to that axis. That means axis of shaft and this. Once again, I repeat, the angle made by the thread with the plane perpendicular to the axis of thread. It clearly means that just you have to identify two locations. One is the plane which is perpendicular to the axis of thread. This means this. And second portion is that you have to locate the plane of a plank. That means this. So ultimately I can say that the helix angle is the angle made by flank and the plane perpendicular to the axis of thread. So this is the angle alpha is known as a helix angle. Then after thread angle, it is the angle included by flanks of the thread. That means it is the angle made by two flanks. We know that this is the flanks. Suppose this is two thread and both of threads have this flanks. So whatever the angle made by these flanks is between them, it is known as a thread angle. Now, after discussion of terminology, third point that we are going to discuss, that is the basic types of screw fastening. Basic types of screw fastening, that means the types of various fasteners that we are using for the different application. First and very much important types of fastener or bolt, that is the through bolt. Look at the diagram, and this is the modeling of that particular through bolt, and this is the real pictures of through bolt. Basically, it is a cylindrical rod with head at one end and threaded portion at the other end, like that. You can also see over here, this is head and this is the threaded portion at the end of other end. So this is the identification mark if you are using through bolt. Generally, pass through the holes of two parts which we require to join. Look at the diagram. This is the hole of the first part and second part. We require to join both of the two parts together. So drill hole is made in this two parts, and this through bolt is inserted in between the holes. And at the end, there is a nut which will be which ultimately tighten nut by spanner. So by clamping force that is produced by nut on these two mating parts, this assembly is possible. One more thing that you require to understand is that whatever the cylindrical portion, that means this, is generally termed it as a body. This is the body of a particular through bolt. And the last thing that we should discuss is that its application. By carefully watching, you know that there is a space required to accommodate nut at the other end. So through bolt can be used where there is a sufficient space to accommodate nut at the other end. This is also its limitation. Second type of a bolt is the tape bolt. Look at the diagram. It's very easy to understand. It is screwed to component, not with the nut. That is the first point. That means as compared to previous case, previous type of bolt, that was a through bolt, in which we have seen that there is a one head at one end and at other end there is a bolt. So in case of tape bolt, there is not like that. Head is provided at one end, but there is no any kind of bolt that is provided at the end. So it is directly screwed to the component to be joined. That means this is a component number one and this is component number two. And suppose you willing to join both of the components, just you have to make drill, create a thread on other part, and just you have to screw the tape bolt through all parts that we require to join here. One more thing that should be discussed is that because of we are not using any kind of bolt here, so it can be easily used where the there is no large space available for the assembly and disassembly of fastener. So over here the bolt is totally removed, so there will be, if there is a complicated space or complex space available for joining, you can easily use tape bolt. It is very cheaper, but in somewhat due to frequent assembly and disassembly, damage may possible. This is its disadvantages. So this is the type 2 tape bolt. Type 3 of threaded bolt is the stud, and this term we have listened numbers of time. Look at the diagram. Stud is generally identified by its threaded portion. Actually, entire cylindrical portion of that bolt is threaded by some we can say that mean. So whenever you are looking for stud, definitely you can see that the threaded portion is cut on outer entire surface of cylindrical portion. How it can be assembled? Well, one end is screwed to the taper hole and other end screwed with the nut. That is very simple to assemble and disassemble. It is used for connecting head of cylinder with the cylinder. This is its typical application because we know that the cylinder and cylinder head are connected, and there should be not any kind of the head or the nut over there. So particularly we should use the stud. Then after number four, that is the cap screw. It is very simple and similar as that of the tap screw, but there is a one change, and change is that it is very smaller in size as compared to tap screw. From the figure you can see that available in large variety in terms of the different shapes of head: hexagonal, circular slotted, and many types of fluted, socket, round head, flat head, and so on. So this is the cap screw. Fifth types of the bolt, or we can say that the fastener, is the stud, and it is similar to cap screw on left hand side, given there is a cap screw. But there is a little bit difference between cap screw and stud, and the difference is that head is slotted in case of stud screw, so it will be known as a stud screw, and generally used with a nut. As it means the at the other end of threaded portion, always there will be a nut. Now number six, that is the set screw. Generally it is used to prevent relative motion between two parts. That means suppose you have operate a lathe machine, and particularly on lathe machine there is a tool post. So tool post is clamped by such type of set screw, and due to clamping force and operating force for performing various operation, large vibration forces are set up. So due to that forces and vibration, your tool should be not move with respect to tool post. So we are using set screw there. Generally, it is threaded to its entire outer surface. Its one portion is headed and other is threaded, or we can say that point format, and it is used generally for the light power transmission. Generally, sometimes it is also used as an alternate of that particular key. Now, after discussion of various types of fastener, it's time to discuss about the various types of locking devices. That means the locking devices is one which offer more clamping force, more reliability, and stronger assembly or strong joint. So first and the most important type of locking devices is jam nut or lock nut. Generally, it is very common such type of devices, jam nut and lock nuts, to be used. 1/2 or 2/3 thickness of standard nut it has as compared to standard nut. Generally, the assembly is look like that. Basically, this is the jam nut, or we can say that lock nut. Assembly of jam nut with the standard nut becomes in three way. First one is the jam nut or lock nut placed above the standard one. Second one, jam nut or lock nut is placed exactly below the standard nut. Or some application you may also find that the jam nut and standard nut have the same height, and which is used alternately. So this is the assembly or clamping method that you can have for if you are using jam nut with the standard nut. But in general, thin nut is always tightened above the standard nut. That means this is the preferably the right method. And due to this, the reason is that because if you are using or tightening the thin nut below the standard nut, you should have the requirement of thin spanner over here in order to lock and unlock, which is not available in a readily market. So just if you are placing that thin nut, or we can say that jam nut, above the standard nut, now it's very easy to open by any kind of spinner. So this is the right method, and why this method is generally adopted. Generally, if you are using any kind of method, one thing is common: the top nut, that means a top nut, either standard nut or the jam nut, have the maximum tension load. Generally, in order to distribute all the tensile load on both of the nuts, sometime both of the nuts are made with equal heads. So this is about jam nut and lock nut. Second is the Kestrel nut. Look at the diagram. You might have seen this type of nut in numbers of time. Especially this nut is used in front wheel of bike, where axle of bike is clamping with this type of Kestrel nut. Generally, hexagonal top surface is given, which is slotted, and each slot having the opposite center line like that. And after assembly, there is a split nut that is inserted between this slot. So there will be a very much strong assembly becomes if you are using Kestrel nut. And due to that split pin or simple hairpin, it gives us a positive lock. That means, first of all, a pin will break, and then after this Kestrel nut will loose, and then after that your assembly will be damaged, or we can say that the parts will be separate out during operation. So it gives more reliable fastening as compared to previous one. Generally, it is used where the parts that we require to join are subjected with heavily shocks and vibration. And that's why what I have said, that this type of Kestrel nut is used in front wheel of bike to join wheel with axle and axle to suspension system. Now third is the Sol nut. Look at the diagram. It's very similar except a few difference in contrastional detail. There is one slot provided in a nut of that particular Sol nut, and one screw, that generally a set screw, is inserted over here. So it provides very much a clamping force to the parts who require to join. So it's very easy to understand from the diagram. First of all, you have to make assembly that you already doing in conventional way, tight the nut well, and then after sufficient tightening, just you have to tighten this shift screw again, so it will produce more clamping force on the joining parts, and in that way you will have the strong assembly of the parts that we are going to join. Fourth number of the locking device is pin, ring, or groove joint. It is very easy and understand from the diagram that the top portion is hexagonal and lower portion is cylindrical. This is cylindrical portion, this is hexagonal portion. Generally, it is a little bit similar as compared to Sol nut, because in that particular pin or ring or groove joint, we are using set screw for the more clamping force. Like there are a pair of set screw that we are using for more clamping force. And in that way, due to that high clamping force, its application finds in marine connecting rods. That means we are using to connect the connecting rods in marine engine. Fifth type is the locking with pin. It's very easy and very similar to previous locking device, except one thing is that there is one drill hole, and in that particular drill hole a pin is inserted so that it will give more reliable operation. Generally taper pin is provided, or sometimes quarter pin is also provided. A split pin can be also inserted for the set type of operation. So this is locking with pin. Now sixth number is the locking with plate and washer. Suppose you are using washer like that. This is the washer, it provides more clamping force and it absorbs more shocking and vibration. So that's why we are using washer along with this nut and bolt system for the assembly of various parts. Generally, it offers the resistance against the external loading in terms of the vibration frequency, in terms of the shocking load. So it absorbs, and in that way it prevents the assembly against the loose of that assembled parts. A split lock washer, look at the diagram, and this is very similar to a step up, but the characteristic of this split spring lock washer is that if you are compressing more, it will become a straight and a flat washer, and ultimately in that way you can have the more compressive force and that way more clamping force required to flatten this spring lock washer, and ultimately the assembly becomes so strong. Then after topic number 5 that we are coming across, that is the bolt of uniform strength. Dear student, up to now we have discussed a lot about the fastening portion, types of partners, types of locking devices, then after basic methods. Now it's time to have discuss about very much important topic, and that is bolt of uniform strength. Generally, as a design engineer, bolt should be designed in such a way that it absorbs a majority of impact and vibration without any kind of deformation. So this is our prime duty, to design a bolt in such a way that it absorbs maximum impact as well as shocks as well as vibrations. But as we know that if we are looking geometry of the bolt, then you will find that there is no uniform cross section through entire length of the bolt, because head has the more cross section, whereas shank has a little bit less cross section, whereas threaded has smallest cross section. So whenever the load is applied, due to stress concentration theory, more stress will produce on smaller area. So it may possible that due to operation or some kind of impact loading or external loading, your smaller weaker portion, that is threaded portion, may get deformed or it may fail. So generally you have to thought that your entire bolt section or entire bolt assembly should have the uniform strength, and this is the concept where through which a bolt of uniform strength is arise. So ultimately bolt of uniform strength itself mean that the bolt is designed in such a way that every section of that bolt have the same strength, and in order to do so, there are two ways to have the uniform bolt strength design. One is the way that your shank should be reduced, like make a drill hole over here and remove that material. So ultimately the area of shank and area of threaded portion will become equal. So we can say that the entire portion have same cross section area, and so same strength offered by entire shank as well as thread portion. Secondly, you should to go for the head to be drilled. But the first method is very important and very easy to do so uniform bolt strength. So make a drill hole, and you have to make a drill hole in shank portion like that. The area of core diameter should be always equal to area of what you have drilled the shank portion. That means right now this is the area of threaded portion and this is the area of shank portion after drilling. So by equating both of the condition is that the area should be equal, either it off from the threaded portion or it will be off from shank portion. So by comparing both of the area, you will have this relation: diameter d is equal to under root d o square minus b c square. Over here d is the diameter of hole that you have made, d o is equal to outer diameter, and d c is equal to core diameter. So this relation should be stand good, and area should be equal in such a way, make a drill hole in such a way that areas of threaded portion and area of shank portion will be remain same. So this is what about the bolt of uniform strength. So dear student, we have discussed a lot on specially threaded joint, its introduction, various types of locking devices. We have also discussed about various types of bolts and special application. At the end, we have discussed very much important theory, and that is bolt of uniform strength. I hope this lecture will boost of your technical knowledge, especially in fundamental of machine design. Still you are finding any difficulty, let me inform, we have a solution. Thank you very much.